Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammā sambuddhassa. Buddhaṃ dhammaṃ saṅghaṃ namāsāmi. I wish everybody a very good evening. Very happy indeed to be here at BIA once again. Every time I come to Thailand, which is about twice a year, I am very happy to receive the invitation to give a talk here and to offer some reflections. So on this occasion, very glad to be with you all once again. Some of you are probably very regular visitors here. Some of you, perhaps this is your first time. But the usual format is I'll offer some reflections, Dhamma teaching for about 45 minutes or so, maybe an hour, and then have the time for some discussion, some questions, answers, and dialogue at the end. Though there's no particular theme that was requested for this evening, so I was pondering, thinking about what might be interesting, might be useful, considering the spirit of Thanajan Buddhadāsa and the efforts that he made in his life, and also what BIA is in my perception, and also my own monastery, Amaravati Monastery in England. So I thought it might be interesting to explore why is a center like BIA useful, or Wat Amaravati. If that's not an interesting subject, then forgive me. But I thought it might be a good thing to explore and to consider. You know, why do the places like this have a value in the world? And say, what say are the ways in which a center like this, or like Amaravati, or other monasteries, teaching centers, what can they bring to our lives as individuals, as members of society? So is that an interesting theme? Yeah, good enough? Okay, we'll see see how it takes shape. So I was thinking earlier today, many, many years ago, when Chitta Viveka Monastery first opened up in England, back in about 1980, which is nearly getting on for 40 years ago, a school visit came to the monastery one day. This is in southern England. And in England, part of the curriculum is that all school children have to study religion. It's the one compulsory subject in the school, is you have to have at least one lesson of religious studies once a week. The subjects like mathematics or English are not compulsory, but they have to have one lesson of religious studies in a week. And also, Britain is a very multicultural society, so they can't just teach Christianity, they have to teach all world religions. So in those days, back in 1980, the Buddhist resources were very minimal. So if a teacher wanted to be giving instruction in Buddhism to their pupils, then they would often ask if they could bring them to the monastery or invite monks or nuns from Chitta Viveka Monastery to visit the school. So one day there was this school visit, and this very keen, sort of ardent young man, maybe about 17 years old, 16 years old, and he had a very kind of grumpy look on his face. And after we had so introduced ourselves and welcomed to the group to the monastery, he said with some strength, he said, what do you people contribute to the gross national product? So I know that's a bit of a technical term, but I hope most people can understand. Like, what do you contribute to the economy? You know, you've explained how you live on donations, and you don't produce anything, you don't grow food, you don't sell wine, or, you know, like the Benedictines, they have their liqueurs, and you don't even make cakes to sell to the public. You don't do anything, you just sit here, and then people come along and feed you. So what do you contribute to the gross national product? So I've always had a habit of being a bit too clever and quick with my tongue. So again, I'm not sure if everyone will understand this, but I said, well, we don't contribute anything to the gross national product, but we contribute a lot to the subtle national product, the kind of refined qualities of the spiritual aspect of the country. He was not amused. It was not funny. And I'm not sure whether he was ever really convinced. But that's a question that can easily come up. Maybe not so much in Thailand, where the value of monasteries and Buddhist teachings have been respected for many centuries, but maybe more in the modern times, where people's faith is shaken in the institution of the religion or the institution of the Sangha. They look around the world and they see different ways of living, different ways of acting, different priorities, different things that people make important. And so perhaps more and more, even in a Buddhist country like Thailand, the question is asked, yeah, why are monasteries important? You know, or a place like BIA, what is the value of a place like this? Probably the kind of people who come after a hard day in the office or at work to come and listen to a Dhamma talk, you probably figured out already there's a few valuable things, otherwise you wouldn't be here, right? But I thought it is an interesting question to explore, because many of the people that we work with, other people in our families, the people that we meet in our lives, they, if you know, even if we are not asking those questions, the people around us do. And still today at Amaravati Monastery in England, we get many, many school groups, sometimes two or three groups a week. And so this is a very regular question for us, like, what do you do for society? Or why should people come and offer you food? Why should they pay for your electricity bills? You know, what is it that you do that makes you so important that people would take the trouble to do this? You know, what's the value? What do you give to the world? What do you contribute to society? So I don't want to make a kind of what they call a laundry list, just one, you know, point A, B, C, D, E, F, G. But reflecting on this, and I feel that it's good to explore that. A center like BIA and a monastery, they have many different effects. Like as a human being, we live as an individual, we live as a member of a family, we live as part of a local district, a town, we live as a member of a nation, we have a nationality, and we are a living being living on the planet Earth. We have a global identity as well. So each of us have a way that we connect with these different levels of life, I would say. And so that a center like this, or a monastery, it has an impact on each of those levels, on the personal, the family, the local, the national, and the global levels. So on the personal level, at Amaravati Monastery, I make myself available. Like teachers like Thanajan Buddhadāsa, Thanajan Chah, they would be available a lot of the day. People who had come to Suodmok Monastery or Wat Nongbapong Monastery, that the teacher would be available. That they would be, Lumpo Cha would just be sitting under his kuti, and whoever wanted to show up and had questions to ask or things they wanted to talk about, then he was available. As you'd say, the doctor is in. And you don't need an appointment, just show up. You know, it's an open clinic. You know? just arrive and you can ask your questions. And so my experience of being at Wat Suan Mok just for a couple of weeks was also that Venerable Ajahn Buddhadāsa was also very available. If people had things to ask and they wanted to see him or talk with him, then he liked to be available for people to engage in conversation and to receive teachings from him. So on a personal level, then people can come to the monastery often asking for advice, looking for advice. Sometimes if the Ajahn is a bit intimidating, they'll go to the junior people to talk to the younger nuns or monks or the novices. If you're too much of an authority figure, you know, you're too frightening as a kind of big Ajahn. But that kind of counseling and giving advice is a very important resource. So people know, I can go to the Wat, I can come to a center like this, and I can get advice, either in person or finding Dhamma books, advice about what is a skillful way to live, choices about our lifestyle, about how to deal with difficulties. You've just been fired from a job, or you're worried about whether you're going to finish your master's thesis ever. You've had a loss in your life. Someone in your family is sick, or you have an illness yourself. So that these kind of aspects of personal advice, personal counseling, are available. A place like this is also a source of meditation instruction. People today have extraordinarily busy minds. The level of stress in society is very, very high. Even when we have a great deal of physical comfort, you know, our medical care is easily available. We have an income that we can happily live on from our work. But still, our minds can be busy, 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 just non-stop thinking and worrying and filled with stress. So a center like this, a monastery like Amaravati, then providing regular meditation classes, meditation sessions or retreats, is an extraordinary resource. So that one of the aspects of life in today and is that we talk a lot about education, we talk a lot about development. But one of the things that gets left off the list is education in what you can call emotional intelligence. You know, learning how to train your mind to be peaceful, train your mind to not be filled with agitation and anxiety. And so that the resources that you have in a place like this, in a way it's the kind of sort of a parallel track education. It's a training. Like the Thai word siksa, to study, comes from sikha in the Pali language, which means to train, to give guidance. Siksa, to study in the Thai language, is to train. So that the aspect of mind training that you get from meditation and the guidance that you can receive in a place like this, you don't get that in school, you don't get that in university, you don't get that in the office. You might get it in your local Buddhist group, in the Dhamma group, but a center like this or a place like Amaravati or the meditation monasteries, that is where you can receive that very particular and significant kind of education. That, of course, my view is very biased. That I have my own particular perspective, but I feel this is something that is more and more important in society, that cannot be, acquired anywhere else. You find a few degrees that involve meditation training as well, but not very many. In a few Buddhist colleges, then they will, encourage or require meditation practice as well, but it's very, very unusual. Also, a place like this is a sanctuary. It's a safe place, so that when we live in society, we live in the world, out and about, then one of the things that people lack is a safe place, a place of trust and security. So that one of my experiences at Amaravati is the number of people who like to come and visit just because they can relax there. They don't have to worry about their possessions. They don't have to worry that someone's going to steal their car or walk off with their bag. Also, no one's going to try and proposition them. No one's going to flirt with them or kind of ask them out for a date. Maybe down in the outside the gate. But in the monastery, people are very respectful. They say, oh, this is a place where they practice brahmacharya, so that's not appropriate here. I don't have to worry whether I'm attractive or unattractive. I don't have to worry about whether that person's attractive or unattractive. I can put that aside because here we are all sisters and brothers in old age, sickness and death. That's a big relief to not have to carry that around. Your social status, whether you're a high-ranking person and you're very rich or you're very poor, there's an equality in the monastery. No one really cares how much money you've got. No one is looking at you as to whether you're highly educated or you have no education. But everyone is there on an equal basis. And that's rare in the world. Even in your family, your office, you know, the kid who got the first class honors degree, you know, she gets more praise than the cousin Joe who just got a third class degree. I'm not reading anybody's mind, but this is how families work. The one who's got the title, you know, the person who's a lord or a kunying or a kunai, you know, that they get an extra boost. But inside the what? Inside a place like this, it's like we're all just pinong. We're brothers and sisters in aging, sickness and death. So that's a relief. There's not many places in society where those kind of values are put aside and we can respect each other as fellow Dhamma farers, fellow living beings. So I feel that a place like this, like BIA and monasteries, are extremely valuable in giving that sense of space, a sense of safety. The Buddha spoke about dana, generosity, in different ways. There's amisa dana, which is the giving of material gifts, like that young lad from the school who was complaining that people came and offered food and gifts to the monastery and the monastery didn't give anything in return. I didn't think of it at the time. I probably hadn't even read about it in the suttas. But the Buddha also spoke about abhayadana, abhayatan. So that abhaya means freedom from fear. Bhaya is fear, abhaya is fearless or fearlessness. So like our monastery in California that was just surrounded by fires, Abhayagiri Monastery, that where I was living. Our friend here was mentioning that. So Abhayagiri means fearless mountain. So Abhayadana is the giving of fearlessness. So what that means is when you are in a place where everyone is respecting the precepts, where no one is killing anybody, killing anything, no one is stealing anything, no one is engaging in sexual misconduct, no one is lying, no one is using intoxicants and so forth, then that means the Buddha said, this is the, if you live in that way, you are giving five great gifts to other people. These are called the mahadana, or the great gifts. Because isn't it a wonderful thing to give to others that when you walk in the room, they don't have to hide their handbag. When they see you, they don't have to think, oh no, it's her. She's always lying. She's always trying to get something from me. He's always angry. He's going to attack me again, even if not with his fists, with his words. So we are. This is what the Buddha called abhayadana, the giving of fearlessness. These are the mahadana. He said, respected, revered, and honored from ancient times. These are seen as being a very refined and noble kind of offering. And he said that abhayadana, the giving of fearlessness, is superior. It's a more powerful and superior kind of giving than giving of material gifts. The giving of Dhamma, Dhamma dana is the sungsut, is the highest kind of giving, but abhayadana is in the middle. So when we keep the precepts, we often think of it as being like, don't do this, don't do that, don't do this, don't do that, my tong, my tong, my tong, my tong, you know. Like it's a kind of containment or a prison, you know, that we're we're fenced in by the precepts. But actually, you can see it a different way. And that when we develop the skillful lifestyle of keeping the precepts, that is a gift to the people that live around us. If you have taken the first precept, Panatipata, the animals that come into your garden, if you have a garden, they don't have to be afraid that you're going to kill them or poison them. But they know, oh, this is a safe place. You know, they will feed me here. This is not dangerous. Like at the Bhayagiri Monastery, the squirrels, the ground squirrels, they would get so casual, they would kind of sit on the rocks and sort of watch the monks as we're cleaning our bath, our alms bowls after the mealtime. The deer would walk right onto the veranda, the deck, and kind of eat the plants outside the house, because they knew that the monks are never going to hassle them, give them a bad time. They know this is a safe place, so that that quality of abhayadana is something very valuable. Also, when we learn these skills, we learn them in a place like BIA or at a monastery like Amaravati or Abhayagiri, but they don't just stop at the edge of the monastery. We learn them there. We develop those skills in that environment, and then we can apply them outside. So if you become the one person in your office or in your university department who never lies, is never trying to get something from anybody else, that you're never aggressive or destructive in your speech or your actions, that you're not the one who's taking the office supplies home, then people know, she's a safe person, she's a kind person, this is a man you can trust. And you become someone who is respected, who is loved, and then you set a good standard for others. Not that you're walking around to people saying, I am a gift to you. You know, you're so lucky to have me working in your office because I'm such a wonderful person. That's more of a kind of inflated view. But rather, you see that if you live in a skillful way, it becomes a blessing. It becomes a source of peace and well-being for others. So on the level of family, often, I don't know how many family events happen here at BIA, but certainly in the monastery, we're often doing funerals and doing dedicating chanting for people who are sick, people who are dying, people who have died, for marriages and for births, baby blessings, marriage blessings, sickness blessings, death blessings. So it's very interesting that we do a lot of these kind of pujas for families. So this is one way that family life is supported by a monastery or by the Buddhist teachings. But our teachers, Ajahn Buddhadāsa, Ajahn Chah, they were very against superstition, as I'm sure everybody is aware. There's a kind of spirit of the practicality and honesty, and referring to the sutta teachings, so that these great elders, they spent many years, 40, 50 years, trying to persuade people not to be superstitious or to be kind of praying to gods and devas outside to come and help them. So it's interesting how Ajahn Chah, he would still carry out the funeral ceremonies, he would do blessings for houses or weddings, sometimes blessings for babies. But the reason, and sometimes he was criticized by the other Kruba Ajahns, the other forest Ajahns, saying that, the monks are at Wat Pah Pong, they waste their time, they're going out to do chanting in people's houses, this is just superstition, it's a waste of time for the monks, this is kind of the wrong path to be going down. They should be staying in their kutis and practicing sitting meditation, walking meditation, nang samadhi den chongkrom. And so in many forest monasteries, the sangha members, they'll never learn the paritta chanting, the praparit. They never learn it, they never do it. Don't do funeral ceremonies either. So Lumpur Cha would sometimes receive criticism for engaging in these kind of customs and ceremonies. But he would explain it often saying, well, you know, it's only when there's a big event in a family, a kind of a crisis or a powerful moment in the family, like a birth or a marriage or a new house, a death, you know, extreme sickness, that's the only time they're interested in Dhamma. So even though you don't want to feed their superstition, it's the one opportunity that they are drawing close to the Dhamma. So there's an opportunity to give them teachings because they're not interested the rest of the time. So I mentioned myself many times in my own family. You know, I've been a monk since my early 20s. I became a novice when I was 21 and a bhikkhu when I was 22. And for years and years and years, my family were completely uninterested in Buddhism, particularly my parents and my older sister. But when there is a family crisis, like a death in the family, or some kind of big accident, some big trauma, then you'd have 3 days of interest in Dhamma. And then they'd start asking, what's Buddhism about? And how do you meditate? And what do I do with my mind that won't stop? And then after 3 days, it's back to thinking about what's on the TV, you know, planning the next holiday, thinking about home improvements, and so on. But we have these, you can call them a kind of PowerPoint, a moment of intense change in the family, then Lumpur Cha would say that's a good opportunity to give teachings because people are not interested, not open at other times. So you can use the time of blessing a baby or blessing a marriage or blessing a house to give people a perspective on their life about the quality of ownership, the sense of their... You bless a house, but you can also tell them, you know, you call this your house, but really it's not your house. You know, if you look for the owner, if you try to find the Jiao Kong, you cannot find what it is that is the owner. So that he would do the blessing, we'd do all the chanting, but at the same time say, you know, this isn't really your place. So you get both the kind of the sweet and the bitter. Yeah, and you get both of those kind of flavors. So in terms of supporting family life, then also one of the things that I find that is a very, very common experience is where the parents will, and again, I'm not keeping track on anybody's life, but the parents will bring the child to the monastery and say, I'm already having trouble with my teenage son or my daughter. She won't listen to me. You know, you tell her what to do. You're the Ajahn. You know, she's misbehaving. You know, can you set her straight? And so 9 times out of 10, or 99 times out of 100, I'll be correcting the parents, not the child. Because literally, yeah, I mean, this happened just a couple of weeks ago. A woman came with her children, and she said, "Yeah, can you talk to my daughter? You know, she's really duh mark." You know, it's a Thai mother, a Farang father. And so the daughter said, duh, you know, well, you can't call me obstinate. You know, when you go out drinking every Friday, Saturday night, and you're still drunk the next morning, how can you go about calling me obstinate, you know, misbehaving, when you're coming home drunk every weekend? She's only about 12. I thought, good point. Good point. You know, what right does the mother have to say, you know, you're misbehaving when she's being an unhelpful example? She's going out drinking. I thought it was quite courageous of the daughter, you know, to say that. Maybe that's a sign of being a bit maybe not dur, but certainly having a readiness to speak up. But I thought it's not the daughter that has so much of a problem, but the parents, because when it comes to family life, very often people are unaware or they don't accept the fact that the main teacher that a child has is the parents. The children learn by example. So, you know, there was that one incident just very recently, but frequently it's the parents will not acknowledge the fact that they are angry or that they are They have very fixed expectations about their child, and that the problem is not with the child misbehaving or being unhelpful or unkind or selfish, but the parents are not being aware of the example that they're setting, that they are very rigid or very angry or very demanding, that they're expecting the child to achieve high academic standards so the parents will be able to boast to their friends. Oh, yeah. Yeah, my daughter, she just got a first class degree, or all three of my sons are now in medical school, you know. So they can kind of feel good when they tell their friends or their other family members. And so I feel that within the family, and the kind of, and hopefully this is the kind of influence that BIA can have. I don't know how often, in what ways advice of this kind is given here, but I feel that sense of taking responsibility and also being aware of the example that you set is very important. And in terms of the well-being of the family, being ready to recognize your own ditti, your own views, your own expectations, and to see that along with your own feelings, your own perspective, the perspectives of the child, the capacity of the child is equally important. Many years ago, I was in the States, I was visiting the Midwest, and a family there, the mother said, this was with a Thai mother and a Thai father as well, and she said, I'm really worried about my son. We're going to have a psychiatric evaluation. You know, he's really in deep psychological trouble. And I said, oh, what's the problem? Because I'd seen him earlier in that day. He didn't seem to be too disturbed or upset or out of balance. And she said, well, he wants to be a social worker. And I said, so? Well, no, he should go to medical school. I said, so you think he needs psychiatric help just because he wants to be a social worker rather than a doctor? Yes. And I said, are you serious? She said, yes, I think he's got a problem. I said, you feel he's got a psychological problem because he doesn't want to follow your plan? Yes. I said, well, let's talk. So I had a long chat with the mother, and exactly about this. And I'm not making presumptions about how you all are here or trying to make people feel bad, but it was amazing to me that she was ready to have her son being so checked out by a psychiatrist just because he wanted to be a social worker. I said, you know, if he wanted to be a croupier in a casino, you know, or if he wanted to kind of be a weapons manufacturer, okay, you know, maybe cause for some question. But being a social worker is quite a skillful livelihood. He's a caring person. He wants to be helpful. That's the kind of thing he's attracted to. Why shouldn't he? And she was just, it was amazing that she was, oh, this monk is, he doesn't understand. He doesn't get the point. So I feel that in terms of the guidance that there can be in terms of Dhamma teachings and meditation for family life and well-being within the family, it's important to recognize for parents that the children are full-scale human beings. They're just younger. And that the more we can respect each other and care for each other in that way, then the more, the quality of well-being can be sustained in the family. Relating to your own parents, you're the next generation up, then of course you have to work with that skillfully. If you listen to this Dhamma talk and then you go to your aged parents in their 80s and say, I just heard Ajahn Amaro and he said that you should respect me as a human being of equal value as yourself. You know, you're not superior just because you're older, then you might have that thought, but it might be think carefully before you, as you choose your words, as to how to put that across. That I feel it's an important principle, but the way we communicate ourselves is also significant. That we can take a Dhamma teaching and then use it as a weapon, say, ah, right, now at last I've got an excuse to be acknowledged, to be recognized. Yeah. But if we look at our motivation and then we say, weigh that up against the situation of our own family and then be guided by that, then we can choose our words carefully, choose the time to speak, and also to say, work on your own attitude in terms of how you see your parents, how you see your children, how you see your siblings. For myself, it actually made my relationship with my parents a lot easier. When I reached the kind of age that they were when they got married and started having children, I could, in a sense, see myself in their shoes. And rather than feeling critical about how they could have done things better in the family, I think, well, why should they have known what to do? Yeah. How should they? Why should they have known exactly the best way to bring up children? Yeah. They were just doing the best they could. And so why should I be critical of them not being perfect or ideal for me? In terms of society and the locality, then oftentimes, again, I'm not sure exactly how BIA operates within the Chatuchak area, but the way that monasteries often function is as a kind of local resource that is a good influence, that even if people just drive by and they don't even go in the gate, they know, oh, that monastery is there, that's where those people practice meditation. That's maybe just even driving past the gate of BIA, they, oh yeah, there's, yeah, Ajahn Buddhadāsa's people are there. They're, oh yeah, it's a great place, I've heard. I must stop in there sometime. So even if people don't use the resource very actively, it has an influence on society that often when we were first, say, established in England at Chithurst Monastery down in the south, it was kind of, in the winter time we would have a retreat for the community and we would not go out on the Bindabata. And so even the local farmers would say, oh, where have you been all winter? We've missed you. You know, I like seeing you walking across the fields, so we enjoy seeing you walking down the lanes. Where have you been? And so you realize that even in the minds of the local people, they like to see the monks and the nuns walking through the countryside. They like to see you with your robes and your bowl. You're a Devaduta, a heavenly messenger. Also, the monasteries often will engage in local projects, like Lumpur Pasanno, who many of you will know, was when he was living here in Thailand, he was very active in the Ubon province, developing as of wholesome alternatives for the local community, forestry. There was a lot of illegal logging and unskillful activity around in Ubon province near Phujomgom on the Mekong River. And so he worked with the local community and the villagers, trying to find different means of livelihood so people didn't have to cut down trees and sell them. He had to also find ways the local authorities who were taking bribes could also maintain getting a benefit from the project, so that he was very active in helping to develop local industries and tree planting projects or forestry preservation projects, and getting the villagers to engage, and also helping them to, say, cultivate their own livelihood. Or like in Bungwai village, just outside Wat Pah Nanachat, then he was also instrumental in helping to encourage a local broom-making industry. So even today, 20-plus years after Lumpur Pasanno has moved to America, they're still there. You can see the broom-making around the houses in the local village. At Abayagiri Monastery in California, where I was, there was there's a lot of drug addiction in the area. Mendocino County and Lake County, there's a huge amount of drug use. And the local medical authorities were, they had looked at various programs around the USA and were, they could see that most of the medical problems and the social problems that came from drug addiction were a lot to do with the illnesses that came from drug use, the AIDS, hepatitis, and the ongoing effects of the injected drugs. So they were looking into developing what they call a needle exchange program, so where drug addicts could exchange their used needles for fresh needles. So people who are really against all drug use say, this is terrible, you're supporting drug addiction, you're supporting kind of the misuse of drugs, this is awful, and we should stop it, we should ban it. Other people, the different end of the spectrum, they say, well, yes, you can say that, but that's not going to stop people taking drugs. And if people use clean needles, then the level of illnesses drops down by a huge percent, like 50-60%. And a lot of the social and medical and financial problems fall away from the drug-using community if they have access to fresh needles. So they had a day-long conference on needle exchange. They were trying to introduce this in our local county. And so I was invited in to this as a sort of spiritual advisor to give a talk on, I don't know how you'd say it in Thai, but to give a talk about moral dilemmas. Like, is it good or is it bad? How do you decide whether something is good or something is bad when it's obviously very mixed? Is it a good thing to give a drug addict a clean needle? Is that a good thing or a bad thing? So in English we'd use the term moral dilemma. I'm sure Thai language has a good alternative. I don't know what that would be. But that was a very active way that we could contribute. So there we are in the monastery at the Bayagiri, kind of practicing meditation, living our lives of seclusion. But when the village, when the local community needed advice, then they said, please can you come and help? And so I was very happy to give a talk that day, and hopefully it was useful. Just recently, as many of you will know, there have been these huge fires around Abhayagiri Monastery. There was about 55 square kilometers of fire, so about 90,000 rai, Gaomun rai, and 2,300 firefighters in the area fighting the fires. So the fires started in the middle of the night, and then there was a strong winds from the southwest, and there were dry. It had been no rain for about 6-7 months, so the place was like a tinder, highly burnable. And the fire was moving at about 70 or 80 miles an hour, so about 100 kilometers per hour, and the flames were about 100 meters high. So there was the alarm went out through the whole area, and at like 2 o'clock in the morning, they set the alarms out, and so there was a huge destruction, about 250, 275 houses in the Redwood Valley area were destroyed. 8 people died from the fire and many others injured. Fortunately, through many blessings and the work of the firefighters and other forces, the Abhayagiri property was not damaged. Just the fire came over the hill and came a bit of the way into the forest, but then it turned back, and none of the monastery buildings were destroyed. So, sadhu to the great firefighters and the forces of protection that helped to keep the fires at bay. But there was a huge amount of destruction. The monastery, there's 3 monasteries on that mountain. There's a Christian monastery just to the north, and another Thai forest monastery just to the east, Luksits of Lumpur Tun, disciples of Lumpur Tun Kipapanyo. So the Lumpur Tun monastery was completely destroyed. They had 1 kuti survived, but about 12 kutis and the main building, Pao Mot, completely gone. So that was very, very sad for all of them. But the Abhayagiri monastery and then the Christian monastery just next door, they all survived, which is really kind of amazing. Particularly the Christian monastery, they're all wooden buildings, and there was raining fire, like raining sparks down on top of the buildings. Yet they didn't burn. So sad. So the but in the aftermath, then the local sheriff and the fire chief, they asked Lumpur Pasanno, well, you know, it's not just the people who've lost their homes who need counseling, but all people, the firefighters and the medics, the paramedics, coming into the houses and the areas where they're finding dead bodies, or like one family that their car, the tires melted, so the car couldn't continue down the road, surrounded by fire, and the 14-year-old boy died, and then the mother and father and the other child were very badly injured. They have survived. Mother lost her legs, and so that they asked Lumpur Pasanno, you know, please, can you be available to give counseling to the people who've lost their homes, their loved ones, and to the firefighters and the paramedics, the people who are coming in, because you know we need help. So that in these kind of crisis times, then the monasteries and the places where spiritual ability is developed, then they become extremely important. When the 9/11 attacks happened in the USA in 2001, planes that flew into the Twin Towers of the World Trade Center and into the Pentagon. So around that time, then every day, many, many people were crowding into Abhayagiri Monastery, just to people who had no former interest in Buddhism or meditation, just to come to a peaceful place to gather together to experience sanctuary. And so I don't know how it has been here at BIA, but I think for many people around the time of His Majesty King Bhumibol's passing away and funeral, then there's a strong pull to come to be with your friends, to be in a holy place, to be in a peaceful place, to be quiet, still, to be not engaging the mind in partying or kind of frivolous activity, but just to be in a serene place and to be quiet, to be still, to respect that kind of important and painful event in one's life. Oh, also the influence of monasteries and centers like this, they spread around not just in the nation and around the world. Again, I won't make a whole laundry list, but there's ways that the monastery is a fertile ground for teachings, and those teachings benefit the people who lead the society. So actually today Ajahn Jayasaro has been invited to give a talk at the palace for the second time this month, apparently within the last month. This is the second time to the new king and the royal court, because apparently they've been listening to his Dhamma talks on YouTube and he's popular. He lives in a little hermitage, sort of a one monk monastery off in Bak Chong, but with the global reach of technology, then you have the people leading society, like say the new king of Thailand and the members of the court. They say, oh, this monk understands stuff. He's got useful things to say. Get him in. Just like the people in Ukiah asking me to give a talk about moral dilemmas and needle exchange. Even though you might be you think, well, we're just this little center, we don't do much, we're just kind of busy with a list of things to do and running the weekly class, but the influence spreads out. And so the effect that things have are not just local, they spread nationally and also globally. I think last time I was here, I talked a little bit about the... if I can remember correctly, a kind of global program that exists now, which is known as mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, MBCT. So it's related to mindfulness-based stress reduction. So a number of years ago, 10 years ago, in 2007, a group of three scientists, John Teasdale, Zindel Siegel and Mark Williams, they were looking at mindfulness-based stress reduction, which is a very sort of globally applied meditation method. It's used within medical systems. It's deliberately, it's based on Buddhist meditation, but it's deliberately doesn't use any kind of religious language or jargon. And they were looking at ways that they could particularly apply the meditation method to helping people with depression. And that John Teasdale was who was at Cambridge University in England. He was a very committed practicing Buddhist, and he had been along to listen to a Dhamma talk of Lumpur Sumedho when he was actually giving a talk at the Oxford University Buddhist Society. And he was Lumpur Sumedho was talking about thinking. It was and how to relate skillfully to thinking. And he made two points in that Dhamma talk that were particularly striking to the Dr. Teasdale. And these were that our thoughts are not true and they're not our own. Our thoughts are not true. They are, at best, they are partially true. And they are not our own. They don't truly have an owner. They're not who and what we are. And so John Teasdale, he took those two principles and he thought, well, maybe we can take those principles of a Buddhist understanding, a Buddhist meditation, and work that together with mindfulness-based stress reduction and develop a new approach. So they developed mindfulness-based cognitive therapy for depression. So probably a few of you are in the medical field and maybe a few psychiatrists and psychotherapists here. So you will probably know that up until 2007, over the last 100 years, if a person had had a recurrent period of depression, so that you've had more than one episode of depression, the maximum say expectancy of cure was between 5% and 10%. So out of 10 people who had had a recurrent period of depression, that 9 people would be guaranteed to experience it again, or 9.5. Yeah. So that the maximum rate of cure was 10%. Whether it was surgery, therapy, psychoanalysis, whether any kind of medical treatment, medication, nothing had a better than a 10% cure rate if a person had a repeated experience of depression. You follow that? So when they did this, they ran this first study with mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, they had a 50% recovery rate. So they published this result in 2007, and everybody said, this is ridiculous, this is 500% better than anybody else. This is a joke. You know, you must have massaged your figures. your experimental method can't be correct. You know, this can't be true. You can't be 5 times better than anybody else in the last 100 years, just through meditation. No way. You know, no medication, no surgery. You know, this can't be true. So then they did another study. The first one was in the UK. The second one was in the USA. And they got exactly the same results. So that's when mindfulness started getting very interesting. That's why even here in Thailand you see mindfulness, mindfulness, mindfulness. That's becoming a selling point, because suddenly the people realize this is amazing, because there are twice as many work days lost per year through depression than any kind of other illness. So more than 200% more work days through depression than heart disease or hand injury, eye injury, back injury. Depression is the major cause for people not to show up to work. So it's a major economic issue as well, worldwide. So even though, of course, this is my own team, so I'm kind of... But I would mention these statistics anyway, even if Ajahn Sumedho was not my own teacher. But here you have a monk living in a monastery, and giving a talk at a little university Buddhist group, but the influence of that then spreading around the world and having a major positive impact in society. Similarly, Ajahn Buddhadasa's teachings, you know, how many countries of the world are there people listening to Ajahn Buddhadasa's teachings, reading his book, how many scholars and academics, how many meditators has Ajahn Buddhadasa's teachings influenced around the world? Millions and millions and millions. So that even though we can say, well, Suan Mok, you know, and today I heard that from the age of 60 to the age of 87, Thanajan Buddhadasa never even left Surat Thani province. So he didn't even leave Surat. But yet that influence is spread around the world. So I feel that when we consider the value of a center like BIA or like Amaravati or different monasteries, then again I'm a bit wary of, as they say, blowing my own trumpet. To trying to say, look how wonderful we are. But rather just to reflect that when a place like this flourishes, when it works well, then it has a huge influence in all these different areas of our life, on the personal, the familial, the local, the national, and the global level. So I feel that the way to look at a place like BIA or like Amaravati is a kind of hospital or an oasis. It's like a pool in the desert where all the animals can come and drink. And that as I said, everyone who comes to a center like this, doesn't matter if you're rich or poor, old or young, whether you're a kunai or a chauban, doesn't matter. Like at the watering hole, at the oasis, there's an amnesty between the animals. The deer will be next to the leopard. They're all just drinking. Everybody needs to drink. At that moment, the leopard will not attack the deer. It says, okay, we all need a drink. We can be equal at the water hole. Once we're away, then I'm going to chase you. But at the water hole, we're all equal. There's no fighting, no argument. There is amnesty. So that a center like this, a monastery, is a watering hole. It's a place where we can be nourished, where our life can be sustained. And that life carries on away from the watering hole. The animals drink there, so their lives can carry on elsewhere. Or like a hospital. You know. You can consider, nobody goes to hospital because they want to spend time in the hospital. I would imagine. We go there because we're sick. And then you go to the hospital in order for your ailments to be cured, and then once your illness is cured, if it's cured, then you leave. You go about your life elsewhere. So similarly, a place like this, then we come here and we are in a sense cured. We are learning the disease of dukkha. And we understand its cause in dhanha, in the self-centered craving. We learn the cure, the Arya Mark Bet, the Eightfold Path, and then that's the treatment. And then the point is being cured, the dukkha nirodha. That's the point. So we come and visit a place like this, or we derive benefit from a monastery. Or a center like this, in order to treat that spiritual illness that we experience, that we suffer from, and so we can go about our lives. The other people who are in the hospital, of course, are the doctors and nurses and the cleaners. they go there because they work there. And so people who work here at BIA, or the nuns and monks who live in a monastery, that the people who live in a monastery, that they are there because they see the value of a place like this, and they have compassion, they have energy, they have interest to provide this resource to the world, and so that they the value of that is something that is important to us, which is why I've been living in the monastery for about the last 40 years, not quite 40, but this is the 40th year. And I see that there's tremendous value. So we don't produce any contribution to the gross national product. You know? I mean, even though you can say that the way that we, in centers like this, we contribute to well-being, the use of meditation to treat depression and other psychological psychologically based illnesses and weaknesses, then that does, in a way, contribute to the gross national product, because more people are getting to work, less people are needing to take time off because of stress and psychological difficulties. But I would say it's like the in Bhutan, they developed the principle of gross national happiness. Probably a few of you are familiar with that. So Bhutan is a very small Himalayan nation, but it's a Buddhist nation. So they changed the concept from gross national product to gross national happiness, the GNH. And you think, well, Bhutan, what kind of influence do they have? They don't even have 1 million people that live there. They're kind of way off in the Himalayas, sandwiched between India and China. But it's interesting that even G8 countries calling upon the Bhutanese government to say, can you give us a workshop on gross national happiness? You know, we want you to advise us. So you get the governments of countries like Canada and France and Italy that say, can you come and teach us what this is about and how you work this? So I feel that, again, this is kind of blowing the Buddhist trumpet, but I feel that a country like Bhutan, with no financial power, no kind of sort of military power, it can still have its influence in the world just through its own virtue, through the manusa dhamma, the human qualities that they manifest, and the wisdom as just speaking in terms of gross national happiness, that it's not a matter of the amount of money that you have or the amount of services that you have, but what really matters is the well-being of the individual. And as we know, that you can have great material comfort now in the most developed countries of the world, say in the UK or the USA or Australia, in Scandinavia, Denmark, Sweden, Norway, in France, Germany, these first world countries, the levels of stress, the levels of attention deficit disorder in children, the levels of obesity, the levels of mental ill health is enormous. There's in Britain, they just recently published a statistic that 40% of the teenagers in Britain between 13 and 16 are suffering from some form of mental ill health. They have mental health problems. 40% of the young teenagers, and they're self-harming or with suicidal thoughts. That's enormous. So that's why I feel, going back to having emotional intelligence as part of our curriculum, developing the capacity to know our minds, train our minds, to learn how to, have wisdom and skillful living, skillful attitudes as part of our curriculum, and the way that we learn, the way we train ourselves, is enormously important. And places like BIA or the meditation monasteries where these principles are cultivated and promoted, where they are discussed and shared, these are of incredible importance, more and more importance as time goes by. So I've spoken plentifully already this evening, so I offer these thoughts for your consideration, and then we can have time for some discussion, questions and answers.
May I invite anyone with questions to Venerable Ajahn? Please raise your hand and we'll bring the microphone to you.
Namaskar, Phra Ajahn. Thank you so much for the talk. I have a question. What advice would you give to people who maybe are busy and stressed every day and they don't have easy access to come to this kind of sanctuary, monastery? Like, how could they, they don't have a chance, they don't have many opportunities to change the environment and come into a peaceful place to relax or to seek advice? What kind of things they can do, or how can they train their mind to live their life with stress and or depression easily?
Well, you should have come to the talk I gave yesterday. Sorry, but it was I gave a talk to the little Bangkok Sangha yesterday on exactly the same kind of theme, and so there's various different approaches. as I said, there's nowadays the global resources you have. I wasn't kidding. You know, like websites for BIA or for Amaravati, Abhayagiri Monastery. There's enormous amounts of material. Dhamma talks, thousands and thousands of Dhamma talks. Ajahn Jayasaro in Thai language. Lumpur Pasanno, Lumpur Puttathat, lots of thousands of English language Dhamma talks. So that, you know, in Bangkok, people complain about the amount of time it takes to travel from one place to another, but, you know, you can be listening to a Dhamma talk while you're sitting with your companions on the road. so that that interest and taking the time to access Dhamma teachings. On our website, interestingly enough, the audio material is far more accessed than any of the reading materials. Also, one of the things I was talking about yesterday at the little Bangkok Sangha group was what I call micro meditations. And so if you have done at least a little bit of meditation, then and you have a bit of a sense of how to calm your mind and focus your mind, then to set the intention during the day to 10, 15 times during the day when you have a moment by yourself, just to stop. Like you, I would often suggest, say, when you come into a room, like you are going into the library and you want to get a book off the shelf, before you go and reach for the book, just stop and just count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then reach for the book. When you've got the book off the shelf and you say, oh, now I want to go and read this, then maybe you stop. If you go into the living room, you know, going to the bathroom, going to the onto the train, just to take a few moments, just when you really stop, pay attention. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 seconds is a long time. And that if you just take the trouble to do that, and in a way of punctuating your day, just making stopping points, then at that moment, then you have a bit of a perspective on what's your mood. Are you sad? Are you excited? Are you sleepy? Are you annoyed? Are you feeling numb? You know, what's the aroma? What's the mood? And often just taking a moment to check in and say, how does this feel? What's the mind doing right now? Also the sense of being on your way to the next thing. Often we create stress by that I'm in the middle of something on my way to the next thing. And we're kind of leaning into the next moment. So when you take these the opportunity to cultivate these micro meditations, you know, obviously if you sort of stop in mid-stride in the middle of the office, people say, you know, what's wrong with Noi? You know, she's kind of frozen. It's all right, I'm just counting to 5. You know, then that might cause more difficulty. So you've got to choose the right moment, the right time. But to just stop, be still, and you realize, well, on one level I'm on my way to the next thing, but the Dhamma is here and now. The Dhamma is not over there, it's here. It's Pachupana Dhamma. It's the here and now Dhamma. It's akaliko, it's timeless. It's not when I finish this job, or when I've got out of the room, or when I've got onto the train. It's now. So that along with that sense of I'm in the middle of something, like I'm in the middle of the questions and answer part of the evening. But still, it's exactly now. So in one way, you're on the way to something else, but on another way, it's perfect and complete, exactly as it is. So another of the very useful methods is to develop an ongoing body awareness, because particularly in an urban lifestyle in the city, we very easily live in our thoughts, in our heads, in our list of things to do, where we're going, who we're with, and particularly with information technology, with everyone's checking their phones. I'm very happy to see no one's looking at their phones during the Dhamma talk. Sātu, sātu, sātu. Well done, well done, well done, sātu. This is no small thing. The world will keep turning even if you don't check on it. It's still there. So, because the mind is bombarded with information, with data, and so that the more information that our senses are processing, the more that we are not noticing everything below the neck. Chamai? So we live in seeing and hearing. So when we're checking our messages or you know, talking on the phone, then the life has disappeared from the neck down. Right? So you can be very tense and not notice it. You know, you can be very, you know, very hot, or you know, very, very hungry, or, you know, or stressed in some way, and not notice it because the attention is somewhere else. So to develop body awareness, just to notice how you're holding the body, your shoulders, you know, like they got an iron bar across them, or you know, is your stomach in a knot, you know, are your teeth clenched? what's your face doing? What are your hands doing? Where are your feet? And just to take a moment, again, even you don't even have to stop, just that, even as you're walking or sitting in a meeting or in the middle of a conversation, you can turn your attention. Oh, how am I holding? How is my stomach? How are my shoulders, my hands? What's my face like? And then it only takes a moment to notice it. You might say, oh, I'm really tight as a drum, or I'm really stiff, or I'm really feeling heavy. And that in that act of noticing, then it helps the system to balance out. It won't, when there's awareness of those kind of tensions and stresses, then they can't sustain themselves so easily. So, whenever you can, to plug into your friends to come to the center. Because as I said, you don't have to live at the watering hole. You don't have to live in the hospital. It's like you get treated there and then you go on your way. So that ideally, the center, you don't have to physically be here. And most people have a non-localized life anyway. You know, that you're not fixed in one place. We sort of, that we live in our blog or our website or we have a dispersed life. So that the more that you use the sense of connection with others, either physically or through sustaining a friendship and connecting to like-minded people, because the Buddha made it very clear that one of the main resources for well-being, for reducing avijja, ignorance, and for sustaining vijja, is spending time with good people. Sapurisa, you know, who are your friends? Who do you spend your time with? Yeah, and so connecting with Kalyanamitta, connecting with good friends, people who have helpful habits. So if your best friend is an alcoholic, yeah, it's something to work on, you know. Really, I was a heavy drinker too, so in the past, yeah, 40 years ago. But who do you spend your time with? What are the choices that you make? So they all have an impact. Okay.
Thank you very much. Khopakun ka.
There's a question here at the front. Right up the front here, Mui. Oh, okay, there's one there.
Namaskar, Prajan. So I apologize for my English is very poor. So recently there is the political conflict in our neighboring country in Myanmar. You know, in the Arakan state, there is the Rohingya genocide that is between the Myanmar army. And sadly, there is one leader by Buddhist monk, Theravada Buddhist monk. Mm-hmm. So how can we... There are many people that ask me about it. the Buddhists in that way? How can we answer them, and how can we respond to criticism on Buddhists? Thank you, sir.
Well, not everybody who calls himself a Buddhist is acting according to the standards of the Buddha. So according to our discipline, if I say to you, you should kill that person next to you, and you act on it, and she dies, excuse me, but just using you as an example, if you act on that, and she dies, at that instant, I'm no longer a monk. Finished. I might be wearing a robe, I might have a shaved head, but my life as a monk is finished. As soon as she dies. So it doesn't have to be any kind of public acknowledgement, but according to Vinaya, then the life as a monk is finished, defeated, parajika. So that is, if that person, even though he's wearing a monk's robe, has been encouraging people to kill others, and if that has happened and they have died, he's no longer a monk. He might present himself in that way, but according to Vinaya, he has been defeated by Mara. He's been defeated in his training, and he is deceiving the public by presenting himself as a monk. So I don't know all of the close-up details, but in terms of our training, also over the course of many centuries, almost every religion, things have been done in the name of Jesus, of Muhammad, of the Buddha, of great spiritual teachers, and you can almost feel the teacher going, "I can't believe that they're doing this in my name," that they would just be like, oh, "How can they do this?" But that's the power of avijja, not seeing clearly. We easily get so filled with our own rightness, we attach to our view, and we say, bend the teaching or bend the understanding so that we find our spiritual authority is backing up what we see as being right. So in the era of the Vietnam War, there was certain so-called monks in this country who, I understand, made the statements that if you kill a communist, it doesn't count as killing a person. And that was being said with the voice of a spiritual authority, which is completely counter to the Buddha's teaching. There's no basis for that at all, not a shred in the Buddha's teaching. But yet they could stand up and say that. And that the Buddha would never, ever condone that. But people get carried away with their own, the kind of momentum. If you understand that, like the kind of pressure of a particular social situation, and they find themselves forced into it. And so that oftentimes good people end up doing really bad things. And that you're not pretending that those destructive things are really good, but you can see how each step of the way made sense. One of the... on that subject, one of the stories I told at that the harm reduction conference in the local town in California about the needle exchange. When I was young, as a teenager and as a young monk, I was a kind of super pacifist, and I had a very negative view of anybody in the military. When I was about 5 years old, they stopped what they call conscription in Britain, so that before, every male person had to join the army for 2 or 3 years. And when I was about 5, they stopped conscription, so they made it voluntary to join the army. So even at the age of 5, I asked my father, when this was in the news, on the paper, and I said, well, who will join the army if they don't have to? No one would want to be a soldier if they didn't have to. It's kind of in my little 5-year-old brain. It's like, no one in their right mind would ever join the army. You know, why would any person do that unless they were forced to? And my dad said, well, some people actually want to be soldiers. I said, really? So anyway, during that that harm reduction conference, I told this story when I had a very unusual illness a number of years ago. I had a kind of strange growth in my neck. And the GP, the doctor, couldn't figure out what it was. And so there was a military hospital, an Air Force hospital close to Amaravati. And so that's where they would send all the weird cases because they had the best medical treatment in the area. So he said, well, okay, I'm going to refer you to the RAF hospital. So I went there and then they did surgery on my neck. And I was in the hospital for 4 or 5 days. And I was waiting in the kind of lounge area for the monastery van to pick me up. And this very elderly, sort of dignified man who'd been around in the hospital on the same ward with a little kind of white moustache, very Air Force, he approached me and said, can I talk to you? And so he sat down and introduced himself. And he was Air Chief Marshal Constantine. And he'd been the second in command of the Air Force. And he had been responsible for many of the bombing raids in the Second World War, including the raid on Dresden, when tens of thousands of people were burnt to death. And it was a non-military town. And so he had led the raid on Dresden. And he told me his story. And so this really changed my view of military people. So in my mind, you know, the raid on Dresden is the kind of epitome of so awful destruction in warfare. And he told me how that happened. He said he grew up in a poor family. He wanted to see the world. So the best way you could see the world was to learn how to fly. How could you learn how to fly when you had no money? You joined the Air Force. When he joined in the 1930s, Britain was not at war. And so he joined and he learned to fly. And he said, I was so clueless, I went to my commanding officer and I said to him, sir, we're a fighter squadron. Who are we supposed to be fighting? You know, who's the enemy? Because Britain wasn't at war with anybody in that time. And he said, silly boy, the French, of course. Yeah. England hadn't had a war with France for about 40 years, so it was about time that we had another war with the French. So he really didn't have a clue. So he was quite a junior soldier in that point. Then the Second World War began in 1939, and it became clear that he had extremely well-developed leadership qualities. His mind was very clear, he was very decisive, people really respected him. And so he started getting promoted. And so he went up through the ranks very, very quickly till he was an Air Vice Marshal when he was only 35 years old, like a very high-ranking officer. He said, with respect to Dresden, all we got was a telegram from number 10 Downing Street that said, Dresden, maximum impact. That's it, three words, Dresden. He said, it was a war, it's coming from Churchill. You can't question an order. So that's what we had to do. So that they launched the raid, and he said a lot of people, you know, were very critical of that afterwards. And I'm not giving any excuses for it. But he said, you know, how I got to that point, you know, each step made sense. And then when it was all over, he said when the war was finished, they didn't know what to do with him because he was so much younger than the officers of the equal ranks. So he said they started taking stripes off me again. So he went down the ranks once more. And they, because he was a war leader, but they didn't have much use for him in peacetime. So he said what he did was he asked for the use of a plane and he flew to every single place that he'd bombed in Germany. He went and visited every single place that he'd bombed and spent 2 years going to every place that they had destroyed. And he said at the end of that time, He said, I made this vow, I would spend the rest of my life doing everything I can to make sure this never happens again. And so that his effort from the rest of his career was in the UN peacekeeping and in the doing what he could to, and at that time, that was before the last Balkan, the wars in the Serbia and Croatia and so on. This was the early 80s. He said, you know, we've had more than 30 years peace in Europe. This is the longest period of peace in Western Europe ever. And so he could feel relieved at that or proud of that. But also the fact that he wanted to sit down in this lounge and spill out his heart for 3 hours to a young guy with a shaved head in a brown sheet. Yeah, because it was a kind of confession. He wanted to talk about it. And I felt really kind of shocked, but also touched that's how it happens. Because you could see he was really quite a noble person, but he had been drawn into this horrific destruction by each step making sense, and how tragic that was for him and all the people who were killed. And that made me realize it's not just a black and white thing, you know, that what happens in these situations, that it's, you can't condemn everybody who's involved, because people get swept along, and that out of good intentions, people find themselves in these terrible, responsible for these terrible things. That, how did I get here? How come I just did this? What happened? And that they couldn't see clearly what were going to be the consequences of their actions. So I feel, it's a long answer, but in terms of the Rohingya crisis and the genocide in Burma, and the responsibility of the government and the army, I'm not making excuses, but I would say to not be too quick to condemn everybody who's in the mix, because like Air Chief Marshal Constantine, you know, that there you get good people with good intentions getting drawn into horrific, destructive action. And that I say that the more wisdom that we have early on, the more we can see what we're getting into, or the more we can make steps to steer things away from those very kind of violent and destructive ends. And I feel that one of the great gifts of the of Buddha Dhamma, again, I confess to being completely biased, but in the words of the Professor Robert Thurman, who's a professor of Buddhist studies in Columbia University in the States and a former Buddhist monk, he said, you know, the Buddha was a soldier before he was a monk. And what he did was he founded a peace army, an army that encourages the resolution of conflict through discussion and understanding rather than through violence, that we solve our differences with each other as human beings through meeting, through discussing, through finding common ground. And that's how we resolve conflict, not through through aggression and just sheer military power or the power of force. So I feel that the Buddha was a visionary of an incredible ability, and that this is what the Sangha is, where this is a kind of peace army, you know, no weapons, no money. All we have is our values, and that creates in a way an example, a doyan for society to draw upon, that we can live and work in such a way that whatever differences or whatever conflicts we have, if we're wise and if we're careful, we can see how conflicts can be resolved through understanding, through discussion and mutual respect.
I know it's taking a little bit of time, but if Ajahn would like just one more question.
Yeah, please.
Okay.
Thank you so much for giving some time for me. So this thing has been bothering me for quite a while. I stayed in India for a whole month, and then I've stayed with a lot of yogis, and I'm now practicing eight limbs of Patanjali's yoga. So basically it's like 24 hours yoga, so you have to follow yamas, niyamas, and then there's one thing under the yama, which is ahimsa. Ahimsa that I have to follow. Okay, I follow this because I think that it will create all the awareness that I should have. And then you have to practice yoga 24 hours without non-attachment, right? So I think that this is the path that I like to go, the non-attachment, so eliminate I in myself, and then non-identification. But then I got stuck in terms of yama. Ahimsa means non-violence, so we practice non-violence, including the speech that we do, so we do not harm other people with the speech or our thoughts or anything. So basically, we do not harm animals, or we don't eat animals, so we have to be vegetarian. But then in yoga, they don't say this right and wrong. So when I see that yoga, they believe in energy, right? So all the living beings or everything is the comprised of all the energies together. So we are all the same, animals and human beings. So all beings are the same. So if we eat animals that are being killed, so we receive the energy of the animals who are suffering. They're screaming, pigs are screaming when they get killed, and then we eat that energy into ourselves, and it turns into ourselves. So we have the negative energy in us. So so I've been avoiding animals like pigs or chickens or big animals. But then I still think that I still need protein, right? So I eat fish because I think that they are less suffering when they're being killed. And then I still have all this confusion towards the non-attachment things that the yoga teaches to be, where when I try to avoid all this negative energy in myself, it means that I'm being so attached into this concept, or I can actually feel it that when I avoid eating this negative energy, then I feel better about myself. So is that also like the contradiction, or how is this view in terms of Buddhism? Or because Buddhists don't really talk much about the eating animals or vegetarian, right? But then I can, like, once I'm practicing this, I can feel that energy really does make difference in me or my spiritual path in terms of knowing, like, more aware in what I do, in even my things that I eat, be more compassionate in terms of other beings too. So I think that is good, but in a way I'm confused, very confused.
Well, I'll try and answer briefly. So there's a lot there. We eat because we need to stay alive. And the first precept is panatipata, not killing. So if people ask for advice, I would say encourage vegetarian food, yeah, and the not killing of animals, but also the trying to maintain a vegetarian diet, you're creating more anxiety and confusion and agitation in yourself, then to see that, well, okay, this is a beautiful principle of harmlessness, but I'm harming myself with all this anxiety and worry and attachment. What should I do? What shouldn't I do? What's the right thing? So I would say the most important thing is to look at what your mind is doing with the principle of, say, vegetarianism, or say, should I eat fish? Should I not eat fish? How much confusion is the mind making around that? And to see that it doesn't have to be that way. Just to recognizing that the mind is making an issue. It's getting caught up in shoulds and shouldn'ts. And so that the more that we are able to see how the mind is creating anxiety and agitation around those things, to principally be training yourself to, have a more skillful attitude. To see that in each moment, it's up to us whether the mind creates a problem out of things or not. So that having the idea that there is the right thing for me to do is a delusion. That we make our choices and then see what the result is. So if you make a choice, like I'm going to be strictly vegetarian, no fishes and no animals, okay, then look and see what the result is. If we live in the realm of theory, what I should do, what I shouldn't do, then you often it makes it much more difficult to see what the actual experience of the present moment is. So that to try things out, you say, okay, well, I like the idea of being totally vegetarian, but if I am, then I'm so weak I can't get up in the morning. Or you realize, you find, actually, I've got more energy than I had before. Oh, that's interesting. I got this idea in my mind, I need protein, but actually just having a totally vegetarian diet and just eating tofu and vegetables and fruit, I feel great. Okay? So you work with what you're experiencing, not what you should be experiencing or the theory, but rather you're letting go of that agitation that the mind creates around an experience, and you're looking, you're being guided by what's actually happening, the real cause and effect. So the more that we can work from the way things are and how we think they should be, the more we're actually attuned to Dhamma, to reality. In some countries, like in China, it's totally expected. Anyone who's a Buddhist would naturally be vegetarian. There, it's automatic. In this country, it's not. So it depends on which kind of strand of Buddhism you're going along with. But that would be my advice, is to use the meditation to counteract the worrying tendency, to relax the attitude, and to just experiment to see what the cause and effect is. And then even if you don't like the idea of non-vegetarian food, if you realize, well, if I don't eat some of this and that, then I sort of keel over and I've got no strength and I have all kinds of illnesses, then take note of that. But I think we might be running out of time. Oh. So that might be the what you have to be content with. If that's the case. It's already 7:40 something.
We're a little bit over the time, but just one more thing that to me, actually personally, I would like Prajan to share about Ajahn Chah, because like this year we 111 year for Ajahn Buddhadāsa, and we have a great event to honor him. I heard that next year will be 100th year of to celebrate the birth of Ajahn Chah, and to me personally, of all the great teacher, he probably the greatest one, because he chose to pass away on the teacher day in Thailand. So we would like to know about the event that Prajan would like to share at Nongpapong of what we are going to do to celebrate his greatest.
Very good. So Venerable Ajahn Chah was born in June of 1918, so we're already in the 100th year after his birth. And because June in Ubon is a sauna, the Hong Op Dua. So holding a big public festival in June in Ubon would be Toraman, Ching Ching, would be a torture. So out of compassion, they're aiming to hold the ceremony to celebrate the 100th year of Lumpur Cha's birth in January. And his death day was January the 16th. So they'll be holding the festival from the 12th to the 17th. This is the current program. 12th to the 17th, and there will be probably about 40 or 50,000 people, I expect, gathering around during that time. And the big day will be the 16th of January. They've built a kind of stone pillar, a very beautiful stone pillar with a kind of lotus flower on the top. In the village and the place where Lumpur Cha was born, in Bangkok village. And around that area, they also have these stone panels, like you have reproduced here at the BIA, with the kind of scenes from Lumpur Cha's life, from his childhood. and the kind of episodes from his biography. So when he was a little boy, kind of giving Dhamma Desanas to his friends in the village, kind of when he's about 4 years old, you know, he'd always be the Ajahn. And pictures of when his best friend told Ajahn Chah that he had a marriage had been arranged between Ajahn Chah's girlfriend and his best friend. So there's a moment of that kind of big shift in his life when his beloved had to get married to his best friend. And then when his father was dying, and then when he became a bhikkhu and training with Lumpur Kinari and Lumpur Tongrat, and then establishing Wat Pah Pong, and then passing away. So they have stories of Lumpur Cha's life carved into stone all around. So there'll be a procession from Wat Pah Pong. It's about 1.5 kilometers from the monastery to the village. So the plan is we have all of the thousands of people, the Sangha and lay people, walking from Wat Pah Pong to the village, to the Sao Hin. How are you going to get 50,000 people into Bangkok and everyone together? Yang Mai Nair. But Lumpur Liam is a monk of incredible ingenuity, so he'll figure out a way to somehow include everybody. I don't know how. Also, he's developed this sunflower program. So when they had the funeral for His Late Majesty, King Bhumibol Adulyadej, they again had the whole road with lined with sunflowers that were all in bloom, all bright yellow flowers for His Majesty alongside the road. So they'll have the same, they've made all these flower pots and they have the sunflowers. They'll be lining the road all the way from Wat Pah Pong to the Sao Hin in Bangkok, the stone pillar. So I'm bringing a group, if everything works out according to plan, of 26 nuns and monks and lay people from Amaravati, and then other groups are coming from Apaigiri in California and Massachusetts in Australia and other monasteries around the world to gather together for January. So please do come along, join the party, the kind of Dhamma party, so no drinking but a lot of good company. Can camp out in the forest at Wat Pah Pong. So, please do come. So the current plan is the 12th to the 17th of January.